Good evening. On behalf of Alan Lowe, our new director, I want to thank you for coming out this evening. You're in for a real treat again. And you understand why I have one of the neatest jobs here at the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library and Museum, because I get to meet people like General John Borling. And he is a fighter pilot. I was just reminded of that. I was expecting him to come over in this wing, and he appeared on the other side, because you never want to let the enemy know where you're coming from. Anyway, I first found out about General Borling, I think it was late 2012 or 2013, early in the year, from the folks at the Pritzker Military Library, who recommended that he might be an excellent person for me to interview. And boy, were they correct about that. And we had a very long series of interviews, and every single minute of it was fascinating for me. Here's a very quick synopsis, because he wants me to be brief. Graduated from the Air Force Academy in 1963. He went to flight school, and not too long after that, he was in Thailand flying F-4s into Vietnam. He was shot down over North Vietnam, as I'm sure you all are aware, in 1966, and spent the next 6.5 years in North Vietnam, most of that at the Hanoi Hilton, much of that in solitary confinement. Now, what does a man do in solitary confinement to keep his wits around him? What the general did was compose poetry. Didn't write it down because there was nothing to write it on, but he composed it and then managed to pass it through the walls to his fellow prisoners and a morale booster for everybody involved. He was released in 1973 and then moved on to the rest of a very distinguished military career. He got his refresher training as an F-4 pilot, and then he was a White House fellow for Gerald Ford administration for almost a year and had that experience. And that's a very elite group of people who have that distinction. Went to the typical Air Force schools, was a commander for the famous Hat in the Ring squadron. They got their fame initially back in the First World War. We're going through that series. He had another command of an Air Force fighter group in Europe. And then, I think it was somewhere around 1986, General can correct me on this probably, he moved to SAC. So here's a fighter pilot that moves to the Strategic Air Command, spent quite a few years there, was in that position at the beginning of Desert Storm and was involved with actually flying missions all the way out from, I believe, North Dakota. I could be wrong on that too. He'll probably correct me on a couple things. All the way over to the theater and then back again. And that was an amazing story just to hear about as well. He finished off his career as Chief of Staff for Air Force North in Europe and was working out of Norway. And there were some great Norway stories he had to tell me as well. After he got out of the service, the man's life was not over. If I've ever met a man who was truly a Renaissance man, it would be General Borling. He helped Chicago run the United Way campaign for a couple years. He soon was involved with sponsoring and organizing a yearly event at Memorial Day at the base of the John A. Logan statue in Grant Park in Chicago. He's an entrepreneur of sorts. He's obviously a scholar and an author. He even dabbled with a bit of Illinois politics and has interesting stories to tell about that as well. But now it's time to hear from the man himself, General John Borling.
I told him to be brief. With all those verbal thunderbolts, I am struck speechless. Almost. Abraham Lincoln and the fighter pilot. I'm already in trouble. Two score and 11 years ago, she was a formidable woman. And she stood on the curb at 2 Lincoln Memorial Drive and said, "Well, I was within earshot. Lieutenant Borling, dress blues, just escaped from the Pentagon, going to my favorite place in Washington. This behemoth on the hoof said louder and now more directly, "Well, will you?" And I, at this point, getting the message, said, "Ma'am." And she said, "Stop the traffic." In those days, there were 6 lanes of traffic going back and forth in front of the Lincoln Memorial. So I threw myself into the vehicular maelstrom and survived. And she, battleship-like, with her brood, crossed me in the wake. Well, battleship is cruel. How about a frigate? Anyway, she was... and walked up the steps to my favorite place in Washington, D.C. I have been to the Lincoln Memorial and taken people there. I like particularly to take virgins there. Well, there are many, actually, who have never been there. You've got to be quick, crowd. You've got to be quick tonight. Free association can be abusive, but you got to ride with me, especially the back row people. I got my eye on you. Presbyterians, all. That's where they sit. There. And it was always stirring to me, especially in the old days when you could still drive around it, where if you had some cojones, as our Secretary of State, Madeleine Albright, was fond of saying, you could park right there and walk up the stairs at midnight, and they used to turn out the lights. Now I don't think they turn out the lights at all. They keep them on all night. I'd like to go there just as the lights were being turned off, and they kept the interior lights on the Gettysburg and on the second inaugural going, and you could have it all to yourself. And they still had the Smokey the Bear guy, you know, over on the left, and he would come out, and with the newbies who were with me, I would have him give a few words about the construct of the Lincoln Memorial, the fact that it was David French who was the sculptor, and the fact that it was Bacon, Henry Bacon, who was in fact was the architect, and the number of pillars and why there were only 36, because that was the number of states, and the other 12 were on the outside, and stories about this, and why the second inaugural had a typo in it. Did you know that? Anybody know that? The word future was inscribed wrong. It was actually an E. Then they tried to patch it over, but there's a mistake in the engraving on the second inaugural. Oh, this is a favorite place for me. It has been formative in my life. And if it was 211 years ago, it was 4 score. That was 1965 for you non-math majors. It was 414 years ago that the Lincoln Memorial was presented to the public. It was inaugurated the day after Memorial Day in 1922, when Memorial Day used to be the last Monday of the month. So this was on the 30th of May, 1922. Anybody know who presided? Taft, as now the Chief Justice, former president. And he, in fact, with Robert Lincoln, who was 75 years old and had to be helped up the stairs, did the official rendering to the country to President Harding. And there were literally tens of thousands of people who were at the ceremony. And if you look closely at some of the photographs, you're disturbed. Dedicating the Lincoln Memorial, and the crowd is segregated by seating. How far we've come, how far we have needed to come. We Americans, and I don't believe in hyphenated Americans for an instant, need to have, in my judgment, a sense of shared values, a sense of destiny, a sense of purpose, and I find it whenever I go back to Washington, I go there often. I've lived there 5 times. I'm a very slow learner. I get my inspiration at the Lincoln Memorial. And so when Mark asked me how was I going to get into this tonight, I wanted to share with you something I have never used on a public platform, which is my affection for the rail splitter, for Father Lincoln. And I hope you take these few moments from my life. And the great thing is I get to go back. I'll be in Washington helping to dedicate the AEI, the new building in Washington. And I'm going on a net jet. I'm not paying. But I'm going with a guy, and he said, what's the one thing you want to do when we go to Washington next week, 29th? I said, I want to go to the Lincoln. And he said, I haven't been there in years. So he's a semi-virgin. We'll do that. All right. And I will regale him with stories. Here's actually a Lincoln scholar of great renown, Bob Lance, a lawyer here and a colleague of mine in the Lincoln Academy of Illinois. If you don't know about the Lincoln Academy of Illinois, shame on you. The Lincoln Academy of Illinois .org is something you all ought to be familiar with. It's a 50-year-plus organization that confers the highest order that Illinois can offer. It's called the Order of Lincoln to laureates who number what, Bob? Maybe 350 or so over our 50-year history. I and Bob are both what they call regents of the academy. We have this Catholic-like structure, you know, where we have priests and bishops and cardinals and stuff. But in our case, we have trustees who are the governing group, some 50, appointed by the governor, non-political. And then there are 18 elected regents, and Bob and I are honored to be elected regents and have a executive kind of power, but it takes the trustees in plenary session to approve anything. And then we have rectors and we have academic trustees. Every four-year college, every four-year university, the president is an academic trustee. And in the fall, after we've done the conferring of the Order of Lincoln in the spring, we, in fact, give to a student from every four-year university recognition as a student laureate and a small stipend of $1,000 to ease them on their way, if you will, into a life full of hope, full of challenge. You always got to have some challenge, don't you? I mean, wouldn't life be terrible if it was just placid and just went on? And, you know, it would be boring is what it would be. And I look out in this crowd, so that's the Lincoln Academy, and our job is also to infuse the spirit of Lincoln. Infuse those better angels of our nature into the greater population, not just of Illinois, but throughout. Bob Lance is one of the great lecturers in that regard. I pale to insignificance in front of his knowledge. And he's grading me, and that's the tough part of it. But as I look out on the crowd, the notion of better angels and service, I can see on the hat. So I just want to see how many, and we have one in the crowd, at least one, a World War II veteran. Your hand up, please, sir. Two, three, all right. I'm fond of saying we walk in your shadow, and we are presumptuous enough, those of us who are still dashing but balding, hoping that some people think it's worthy to walk in ours. The only gripe I have with you guys is you are not the greatest generation. If you were, our best days are behind us, and I can't accept that as a nation. Not funny, it's very serious. We need, as a people, to keep injecting potential in terms of spirit and performance into the country. We need a fighter pilot attitude to do that. We need to be, wasn't it Jefferson who suggested we needed a revolution every couple of generations? God knows we're going to get one this time. I hope. So you were a great generation, and we're so grateful. In fact, this ring that I wear, made out of vitalium, which was a dental metal in World War II, was made by my uncle, his bombardier, when they got out of prison camp in World War II. It's got the officer's crest on it. And this is probably the dearest thing next to my original wedding ring and Air Force Academy ring that I have. I'm going to pass it around, but please treat it with respect and gently, because the four guys that got out of the B-24 over Leipzig on a DP, I'm talking to the World War II guys, the heck with the rest of you, the DP are only the guys with a ring made out of that metal by Talium got out of the airplane. Everyone else was killed. They were all wounded, captured, and spent 22 months in Stalingrad I. So this was their celebration ring. When I went to my first war, my uncle gave me that wolf's head ring. He called it a get-me-home ring. Well, I might as well get into that story now. We'll be back to the veterans in a minute. But the night I got shot down on my 97th mission, I got out of the airplane low and fast. In fact, I didn't get a swing after the ejection. I got out, and if I'd gotten a swing with the chute, I would have been killed. I just hit it and hit and rolled down about a quarter mile of a furrowed hill and rolled up at the bottom. It's in the book, by the way, this book. I've only recommended four books in 30 years. But in the book, you'll see that I talk about laying there with a broken back, everything sprained, broken ribs, can't walk, and they're all around me. In fact, the road, Highway 1, is just where the back row is, and they're shooting all over the place, and I managed to crawl into a log over here, and I get down to Highway 1 later after they've gone up the hill. They miss me, and I figure the only way I'm going to get out is if I hijack a truck. Break all the rules, which is never make contact, but I couldn't walk. I was Rambo, and I couldn't walk because I was a survival instructor, paratrooper, or I'd been through Ranger, or at least a part of Ranger. I was not a Ranger, but I really thought that they'd never get me. So I go down, I get a staff, and I crawl down, and I get down to the road, and I stand in the middle of the road with my six gun, and I jack a truck. How about thumb apples, huh? I have just hijacked a truck full of North Vietnamese regular troops. I don't think it's funny at all. I have reviewed that management decision on more than one occasion. They stripped me nude. I know some of you, I will not show my abs tonight, but they stripped me nude and ripped the ring. I wore the wolf's head ring on my dog tags, and I opined to myself, that's not a get-me-home ring. That's a get-me-shot-down ring is what it is. Well, when I was in those early years when you're alone or in semi-isolation, living in a very confined space, no visibility outside, everything's bricked up, the only thing you had to create some kind of presence was this tap code we had developed. And are you familiar with the tap code, sir? This is Dan, by the way, Dan Kushner, who is the head of the Illinois Beverage Association. I pronounce your last name. Klausner. Say it again.
Klausner,
close enough. And I'm a fighter pilot. I don't get that. Dan knows what I'm going to say now because he told me earlier when I spoke to that oldest of the trade associations in Illinois, and the executive director is sitting right here. They didn't pay me. They were most welcoming, but I said, you know about the tap code, and he said, no. And I said, well, the next time you get thrown in jail, you know, you'll be able to talk to the guy next to you if you look at it here in the book. So, same goes for you, sir. All right. Anyway, I'm in one of those rooms and cells, and there's a banging on the door, and I hear a guy go in next door to me. This goes back to the ring, and pretty soon when the jailers have gone away, I get the shave and a haircut, and I come back, and I say, hi, it's John Borling. Who are you? Because you don't know who it is. You try to pass your name because you're presumed dead. We all, for the most part, were thought not to have made it. And he says, Pop Kern. This guy's name was Dick Kern. He was a captain. We called him Pop because he was so old. He was, I know this is going to be hard to believe, this guy was 57. Can you believe anybody is that old? And Pop, and I said, Hi, John Borling here, in the tap code. And he tapped back, Hello, Dick. And his name, first name was Dick, and I thought he was confused. I said, No, John Borling. He said, No, Dick Borling. I was with you in Stalingrad I's South Camp in World War II. This guy was a two-time loser and had lived with my uncle. Yeah, there's the rest of the story, Paul Harvey-like. I'm going to pass this ring around, which was the celebration ring. As I went home after the war, I said, Dick, when you die, I want that ring, and it's a prized possession of mine. But this is a great crowd. So we'll start here and just pass it around. You'll see a authentic thing from World War II, as authentic as the gentleman sitting back there. Again, thank you very much for your service. Let's bounce to Korea. Korea guys here, thank you so much. Are you warm yet? I hope you're warm. Terrible war. They're all terrible. Then we bounce forward to the welcome home guys, all the welcome home guys, Vietnam era. Thank you. Hey-ya. Look at the hand. In the book, I'd recommend, by the way, we are restricting couples to 20 copies a couple. We just don't, you know, that's just the way it is. Well, I'm making the assumption that some of you may have friends. No way. I've already stolen your book. I mean, you're going to have to get another one, you know. All right, thanks, guys. Welcome home. It means in the book, you'll find out we won, too. In 2002, I went back to Vietnam with a White House fellow delegation, and we went from south to north and ended up in private session with Bon Nguyen Giap, who was the defense minister of North Vietnam. He was one of the original revolutionaries, along with Pham Van Dong and with Ho Chi Minh. By the way, Ho Chi Minh's death probably kept us alive when he passed in 1969. When were you over there? What were your years? 70, 71, right toward the end. Thanks very much. In any event, Jop was supposed to give us 5 minutes. And I went out being the interlocutor for this portion of the trip. And General Jop was coming in. And I went over to him and I said, General Jop, je vous connais bien. I know you well. And he said to me in French, je vous connais aussi, General Borling. I know you as well. And he took my hand and we walked in together into the briefing room where the delegation was and where the Vietnamese press and all were lined up. Sat down next to him. He spent an hour with us responding to questions. When it got tough, I'll use Angela as my training aide here. This is Angela Sterin from the Foundation, the Abraham Lincoln Presidential Library Foundation. It's a lot for me to remember, blinded by beauty as I am with so many of you. What was I talking about? No, the reality is that he would take my hand when the stuff got tough and pat my hand. And at the end, he gave me a book of communist drivel. If you want to read anything that would really, if you have trouble sleeping at night, I suggest you read Historical Materialism. If you get more than 3 pages into it and you're still awake, you're probably asleep anyway and just don't know it. I mean, he assigned it on your return, Bon Nguyen Giap. But he told me what you guys need to hear. We won too. And if you, how many people have been back to Vietnam or have been to Vietnam ever, other than not in the war, but back to Vietnam? The lady I called, one of the most elegant ladies here tonight. When were you there?
I'm not exactly sure. Cruz, General Teller was at our table, and General Teller was head of the.
What year group was this? All right, when you think of it, you tell me. How many, 15?
15.
Okay, great. And who else, who was back to Vietnam? 1985? 95, all right, great. You were there relatively early, as 15 years ago, about right at the turn of the millennium. Didn't you find there was an inordinate interest in things American and a love of America? I mean, you couldn't go anywhere, especially the young people. When we were there in 2002, half of the population was under the age of 24, had no independent recollection of the war, wanted everything to know about how to get to America. Their kids are more literate in English than our kids out of the big city public schools are. And they are probably our best friends in Southeast Asia. Amazing. Well, I go through all of that being somewhat of a hodgepodge, going from my relationship with Father Abraham to segueing into the business about the book. And while I think I can go on for a long time, I don't want to be unmindful of the fact that you all may have some questions. So I'm going to talk a little bit now as the second subject, since I've got my bona fides set as the fighter pilot in Lincoln and the effect that he's had on me. By the way, Mark mentioned that we do the Logan statue thing in Grant Park, and I would just ask anybody here in Chicago, whose statue is in Grant Park? I want to see how sharp you are. Who? The lady up here says Grant. How many people think Grant? Nobody. You have nobody with you. No, you're with you. Anybody else think Grant's statue is in Grant Park? Lincoln's statue is in Grant Park. And whose statue is in Lincoln Park? Grant, exactly. Well, why wouldn't we figure that out? I will not ask you who the four statues are in Lafayette, five statues in Lafayette Park off the north portico of the White House, unless someone wants to stand up now and just tell me who they are. That's a test question later when I'm signing books after the thing is over. One of them is Lafayette, obviously, but okay, let's talk about poetry for a minute. You came here under the impression that there were going to be some dramatic readings. I'm not a very dramatic guy. In fact, that chair behind me was, in case I get into my Dave Garraway mood. I never get into my Dave Garraway mood. But I would be dishonest I would have a bias if I didn't talk to the... I would be my wife, is what I would be. We've done some test questions. You recall, no fair answering, you recall that Illinois derives from the Algonquin Indian? Mark, you told me this was a kind of an astute crowd. I'm getting a lot of blank stares out there. In Algonquin Indian, I won't even ask you to translate. In Algonquin Indian, Illinois translates, are you ready for this? Tribe of superior men. I was impressed with that factoid, and I made a little sign up, tribe of superior men, and put it in the kitchen so that when my wife of 53 years came down, she would see the sign Tribe of Superior Men. And when she came down, she saw the sign. She took the serrated knife that you use for hard bread and reduced it to rubble in instants, consigned it to the outer darkness. I got to take it there. I never knew my wife was so biased against Algonquin Indians, which brings us back to the bias that I said I need to talk about. And my bias, quite sincerely, is that this is a piece of my soul. And if I don't do anything tonight, oh, I would hope to be mildly entertaining from time to time, but if I don't do anything tonight, I want to leave you with some genuine thoughts so you can kind of peer inside with me. Is that okay? And then you guys can probe as you will with questions. Is that fair? So in those early brutal years when you read about it, you know how bad it was, the notion that we had to survive was important, but it was much more important to survive with honor. We wanted you to be proud of us when and if we came home. And I wrote this book, starting to write it as a way to stay competitive, as a way to make time an ally, a way to run an uncertain race, so that my wife and little girl, who was 3 months old when I left, 7 months or 7.5 years old when I came back, would have some kind of legacy in case I didn't make it. And I would tap it through the walls as I created these things in my mind so my fellows would carry it with them, gave them something to do as well. And as the years went on, the book grew. And if you looked at it, you see that John McCain did the foreword. But later on, when conditions improved modestly, in fact, they tried to fatten us up the last year or so, then it was a more normalized but never a real POW setting. We were always considered to be, by them, war criminals, and then released in 1973. And these poems were, I've been carrying with me and reciting them daily, reciting this book almost daily. And we got to Clark Air Force Base in the Philippines. That's where they flew us out to on February 12, 1973. And after a first meal, what was the first meal? What do you think you want to eat when you have your first meal? Think about it. Have you ever been, how many people have been really hungry here? I mean, really hungry. So what meal would you hanker for more than any other meal? Shout it out. Bacon and eggs, breakfast. You hanker for breakfast. And then once you've had that breakfast, you go back to having a Coke and a candy bar. But that's, you know, you've had your breakfast. That's a fighter pilot's breakfast, a Coke and a candy bar. And I ran out, still in a bathrobe, ducked out of the hospital and went to the BX. I didn't have any money, and to the post exchange. And I said, I need a tape recorder, because I wanted to download. That wasn't even a verb in 1973. I want to download. And this guy comes back, and he's got this black shoebox-looking thing. And I said, no, I, you know, Tanbergs or, you know, Akai's with the tapes and the reels. Remember, guys? And he laughs, and he said, this is a cassette recorder. And I had no idea, but I owned one. In fact, I just took it. I didn't have any money. And it went back later and paid for it. And went back with the little cassette things and started downloading these poems. It's strange, because if we went up to a teenager today and handed him or her a cassette recorder, they'd say, what the heck is that? You know, you no clue. And then I buried the book for 40 years. And it was John and others, who you'll see on the back, who came and said, you need to publish before you die. Even though I have this mirror that talks to me every morning and says, Borling, don't ever die. And I intend to take that instruction. The book's in four parts. The first part is the flying part, because flying equals freedom, equals flying. And the second part is the dark and bitter stuff, the human nature things that we wrestle with and the POW experience. The third part of the holidays, the wonderful ups and downs of the Christmases and Thanksgivings and birthdays. You know, when the family comes over and you find out of all your relatives, you like yourself the best. And they would expect a Christmas poem. I'd pass it through the walls. And then the last part of the book is Sea Story, Southeast Asia Story. Writes about all the things you really care about. Sex, politics, religion, love, hate, war, peace. Every human emotion I could consider in a sea story. We've got Navy guys with us, but this is a Southeast Asia story. So again, my advice to you is read the front, read the back, and then dive in and out of the poems and laugh, cry, and think, and be careful with this piece of my soul. You want a couple tastes of some of the stuff? There you go. The first poem in the book is called The Derelict. People have been to Arizona, Phoenix, out here. If you go further west and get out to Ajo, that deserted base out there in the desert, your heads are nodding. Ajo was the model for this. I'm not going to give the whole thing. I'm just going to try to give you a little flavor. It talks about an old airplane, in this case a B-17, flying back into those deserted kinds of bases, trying to go home again. The derelict. The West was a patchwork of color flung over a racing sky, and the wind was a lover's whisper that needed no reply. And the strip was of weed, corn, concrete, scarring the desert floor, and a derelict came flying. A derelict came flying, long final to 04. And it talks about this B-17 going back and trying to find its past, trying to find its present. The last lines of the poem, and it doesn't hack it, the last lines of the poem are, take off rolling the farewell drone, unheard in the desert air, outbound, in search of home again, trying to go home again. And all who follow it home again will never find it there. My poems, a lot of them rhyme. Which is strange in a present-day context. In fact, I had a New York critic say, she didn't say poems, she said, poems. You know, you rhyme your poems. And I said, yeah, I thought poetry was supposed to rhyme, you know, a lot of it anyway. And she says, and you know what else? She said, two of your poems, you may have created rap, for which I most humbly apologize. Now, I do a lot of, I like the sonnets. And I know some of you, and in fact, I've got you doped out already, some of you are rabidly Elizabethan. Others of you, you particularly, are a devotee of the Petrarchan structure. I know I've got you typed. I saw you when you walked in. You are definitely a Petrarchan type. But to satisfy both of you, believing in compromise, I melded the two. Still used the 14 line, did a rhyming couplet at the end, that solves everything and that goes before and has a rhyme scheme that's attendant to sonnets. I'll just give you a piece of a sonnet called First Light Flight. I did it actually on the radio this afternoon. Did anybody hear it? So it's new news, old news. Live through it again. It's great. I used to fly weather recce out of George, and we've got guys who flew F-4s at George. Raise your hand again, colleague from George. He's already left. No, there he is. Be brave. No, we were at George Air Force Base. This is where Roy Rogers had his museum. I rode horses with Puerto Rican teenagers about 3 years ago in the surf of Puerto Rico, and we're riding along. I said, God, I feel like Roy Rogers. No clue. But I'll give you something for your Puerto Rican friends. You know the most overused word in the English language, at least in America? Awesome. Gosh, I hate the word awesome. So I asked the kids from Puerto Rico, I said, what's the equivalent of awesome? And they said, brutal, brutal. And if you say, que brutal, you're saying, hey, something's really great. How the hell do we get on that? I was talking about flying weather recces out in the early morning, and you could have multiple sunrises. So this poem called First Light Flight talks about flying at dawn. Pale golden talons stir the eastern sky. Another fledgling day departs the hills. It takes the air as thermaled falcons fly, cascading light as carefree first flight thrills. And who attends that noble soaring birth from mountain crag or gentle rolling plain may marvel from their vantage point on earth, but miss so much, not of the sky's domain. But I'm not of the earth. At altitude, I greet the infant day with engine song, my contrails etched on endless morning blue and rare abandon, urging me along. It's here, unfettered brother men enthrall to first light flight, the one judged best of all. I really like that one. I think you can probably tell. In the second part, have we got 15 minutes yet before we're running out of time? Angela's my timekeeper here. Am I going too long? You guys are still with me? Can we go a little longer? Is it okay? All right. How much? I've got 20 minutes left. Oh, I'm a fat 20 minutes left. I'll give you guys 2 minutes for questions. The second part is the dark and bitter stuff, the POW stuff. The hard part about doing this book that you buried for 40 years, and Myrna and I did not want to be professional POWs, so we rarely referenced it, asked about it. Doing the book now has thrust it back, and sometimes it's difficult, and this one's a little difficult. Hanoi Epitaph. Remember where I was at this time. I was in a space no wider than this, no longer than this, and the walking was 2 1/4 paces and turn around and go the other way. When days of dim hope and boredom abound, and you half listen to the desperate sound of empty tap code conversation, when the heat is so hot and the cold so cold, you think of your youth and how you've grown old. Now live confined, it's life's lowest station. When the floor is furrowed by tired feet and life slips away neath the pounding beat, you trudge on in the dark desolation. The poem goes on in a similar vein for about 15 verses, and it concludes with these kinds of thoughts. When years have passed, the many Decembers, and no one knows, and no one remembers the sound of your voice, your face, or your name, so you dream of steel chargers, skies to roam. Mostly you dream of just going home. But you dream without hope or conviction. So I tapped that a verse at a time through the walls, and didn't get much reaction as it passed its way down. We had maybe 12 guys that were lined up down there, but a day or so later, they said, hey, about this Hanoi Epitaph thing, we're thinking of forming a suicide pact, and we're wondering if you'd like to... Actually, we had optimists and pessimists up there. I appreciate your index of humor, sir. It's exactly where it should be. You're disturbed, not deranged, just a little disturbed. You join me. No, the optimists, it's in the book, by the way, this next line, it's an original. We had optimists and pessimists. The pessimists thought we were gonna die up there and they wouldn't even send our bodies home. The optimists were sure they'd send our bodies home. And Nothing like a little gallows humor to get you through, right? And then it's the holidays. Then it's the holidays. And one thing was called a part of, so I had to write a Christmas poem every year. And you know the pathos, we've already talked about relatives and things and how it goes up and down at Christmas time and other times when families gather. So I wrote a thing called A Part of Christmas, going back to Chicago, and it starts out like this. When Jack Frost starts, the warming hearts, and old man Smith ain't mean. When reindeer fly, and you can buy a purple evergreen, then something's up, and you know what? It's all a part of Christmas. And it goes on and talks about going to the walnut room for lunch, and it talks about doing a number of things, but then ends up with the pathos of you're alone, as we all tend to be with our own thoughts on a Christmas Eve. I did it, and so that was fun. There was a year when I did one called Mommy, Where Is My Daddy? Where I imagined my daughter Lauren laying in bed listening to Myrna pacing on Christmas Eve and telecommunicating with her the thoughts. And then Myrna getting the thoughts and responding back, and then me answering from across the way. That did spawn a suicide pact, but luckily we averted serious loss. And I'm not going to do it tonight. It really rips my heart out. But if you get inside the book, I recommend, like most poetry, if you're impelled, read it out loud. Poetry is best when read with expression. Your own interpretation. Even though some of this stuff is at various levels, most of it's just like looking at a stool. Imagine this is Andy Warhol or something like that. You either like it or you don't like it. It's either a soup can or it's whatever, or it's some wonderful piece of art. All art ought to give you a plus or a minus almost immediately, and I hope my stuff does that. In fact, I go so far as to think this is diverging now down a tributary that is important but not central to what I was talking about, and that goes back to our problems with education in America. I would submit that our problems in education in America begin with the fact that we've not defined what we want out of our public school system in terms of educational purpose. So if you all would quickly finish this sentence in your mind, the purpose of the American educational system is to, I'm going to give you a couple seconds. The purpose of the American educational system, K-1 through 12, is to. Everybody got their answer? Here's mine. The purpose of the educational system is to provide the student with the skills and the confidence to identify and solve problems. That's what we do in life. And have good manners, and appreciate beauty. Appreciate beauty. Wouldn't it be a wonderful world if, and I'm a trained engineer from the Air Force Academy, but I majored in humanities, and I've always been convinced that the world would be a better place if we would just pause and accept and embrace beauty, with creativity being the essence of the human condition. I mentioned that today on the radio. And it doesn't have to be artistic creation or poetry or music or whatever. I wanted to be a jazz pianist, but got laughed out of the Playboy Club one night. I did. I was playing up in the library in the old place on Walton Street. I was playing Jesus Loves Me. Do you know the song? Can we hear a little bit here? Would you start it off, ma'am? Jesus loves me, yes, I know. For the Bible tells, very nice, very nice. Heartland, Illinois down here. But at that point, I had the bass and drums kick in, and we did five-finger Brubeck chords and swung Jesus Loves Me. This blonde in the back, blonde in the front, blonde in the back, started giving me the old Chicago razzmatazz, you know, no talent, you know, get off the stage. So I decided then and there I would never be a jazz pianist and became a fighter pilot. Married the blonde, yes, that's true. beauty, the love of beauty. So skills and confidence to identify and solve problems, have good manners, and appreciate beauty. And I would hope in my book that you would get some flashes of beauty. You'd either like it or you wouldn't like it, and we go on. But now we're through the third section, and we're going to the last section, which is Southeast Asia stories. And it's about 12-line stanzas as you go through it. And I'm just going to give you, since we are falling into the historical peril of fighting wars forever, historically it's the end of nations or the great diminishment of same, because it affects national spirit, it affects treasure. Basically, we just don't like it. If the game is worth the candle, the Congress needs to do its job and solicit that public opinion, fear, hate, loathing, whatever interest, whatever it is, and then declare it, absent the president's ability to respond to attack, obviously, and then give it up to the military mission-type orders, and it says, go take care of that, and wrap it up. Okay, so this is what's out of, this is what's in Sea Story. So once elected, war the objective. Wrap it up, neat and fast. It won't be pretty, and that's a pity, but better first than last. Moral, immoral, senseless quarrel. Winners are right in history. I tell you once more, the fact is in war, no substitute for victory. And I suggest that as a nation, we can hearken to those abbreviated words of MacArthur and be prepared as a nation to take up arms when it is truly in our interest, or when there is truly a fear factor, or when there's a hate factor. That's the rough stuff of war. I wish it were not so, but it is, and we deal with that subject and many others in Sea Story. So again, get in and out of the four sections. You will laugh, you will cry, you will hopefully think. Did you want me to give you a piece of that rap thing just for fun? Finish up there and then turn it over to questions and answers. Do I dare? Remember, I was writing some of this for fighter pilots, all right? In fact, I was writing it all for fighter pilots. The story concerns a couple of woodpeckers. I've got to give you some background. Down in Texas, one's named Maggie. Magnusons are always Maggie in the vernacular. He's the old guy. He's the instructor pilot. And Jamie is the young guy, Jamie Joe. And they decide, after some things here, that they're going to take a cross country out to the west. So it starts out. You ready for this? All right. This is the rap stuff. Well, way down south in the Texas flat, where Prickle Pear and Jack Rabbit at, live two woodpeckers in a sawed-off stump, a-looking all the day for something to thump. Well, it's white man rap anyway. I don't know. It's, you know. It happened one day, as I recollect, sitting on a choya with something to peck. Maggie, the old guy, turned to Jamie, the young guy. Say, brother O, I got me an ID, think we ought to know. From yonder back north to San Antone, local flying wood is dry as a bone. Cottonwood, willer, other thorny thing, just don't fill the bill, that empty holler ring. But I heard tell of a promised land where trees grow tall and the pecking's grand. California redwood's supposed to be best. I'd be of a mind to mosey on out west. Well, the story goes on in the same kind of vernacular and the sing-song stuff. And they, in fact, fly out of Laredo, Texas, until they get out west to quick stop at Kirtland. That's in Albuquerque. Quick stop at Kirtland for turnaround. Moon pie and coal, another tank of gas. Soon headed west again, really hauling fast. All right. Oak Creek Canyon, everybody knows Oak Creek Canyon, north of Phoenix. Real pretty passed by. Jamie thrashing weeds, but Maggie stacked high. The two ski-daddled in their feathered flight, pleased as Mr. Bullfrog on a moonlit night. Talks about them flying on. And then the weather gets a little iffy, and they've got to get up and get an instrument clearance to get on top of the clouds. and they do this, which we've all done. You've heard it. We are entering into holding. They entered into holding by and by. Weather might touch you to Maggie's eye. We better take a TACAN, radar 2. These are ways to get down. TACAN, radar 2. Caution be the watchword, for we have a chew. Well, Jamie started fretting, young and bold. They called for clearance, continue to hold. Jamie, so bothered, so anxious to peck, he rolled to his back and split-est to the deck. That's a maneuver where you lose a lot of altitude and you go down and hopefully you pull it out before you hit the ground. Well, luck of a rebel helped him down, landed on a tree, commenced to pound. He just reared back for that first giant peck when come bolt of lightning struck him in the neck. Poor old Jamie, laying in the brush, tail feathers singed in a deathly hush. Maggie was on final. He touched down good next to fine full stop and a likely hunk of wood. Poor old Jamie, laying in the brush, tail feathers singed in a deathly hush. I just said that. Maggie stood looking, shook his head. He's looking at Jamie. Maggie stood looking, shook his head. It's a wonder I declare you ain't dead. Now, I've seen me some sights and heard me some tales. There's one thing I know that holds for all males. Boy, before you fly again, think on these words. It's true for man and it's true for birds. No matter what you call it, love or sin, don't be such a hurry. Put your pecker in. Thank you, Mark. You told me this crowd had literary potential. And at that point, I will end with a story that you've all been waiting for. It's the story of the Kennedys on their wedding night. I guess picked up by the frogmen in the waterbed. I don't know, but it came out. Jacqueline turned to Jack Kennedy on their wedding night, apocryphally, and said, "What kind of man are you, Jack Kennedy?" Wondering how I'm going to get out of this. "What kind of man are you, Jack Kennedy?" And he said, "I'm an idealist without illusions." I would leave you with the finale of prepared remarks, with the heartfelt notion that we Americans, I think, thrive on the fact that down deep, we are essentially idealists, but without illusions. We are willing to accept broad error, mistake. We do like honesty. But at the end of the day, if we thrive as a nation, it's because you, and we have an idealism that will sustain us into greater generations of the future. I try to imperfectly march that path. I'm sure you all do it much better than me, but let us go forward as a nation, as a people, and not be afraid of American idealism and the notion that shared values, are sustaining, much as you have sustained me with your wonderful reaction tonight. And now you may try to pillory me with questions, and I thank you very much. Thank you. I will repeat the question, so don't think that you have to scream, but then again, I don't have my hearing aids in, so scream. Or if you're a woman, you may come down and whisper seductively. That's the other. Yes, ma'am. Thank you. You should thank my mother. Well, you know, it was George Bernard Shaw who suggested that you think about what you want to think about and pretty seriously, but then say it with a fair bit of levity. And some of this stuff, frankly, is painful, so I do try to put a lighter touch on it. But you had a second part to your question. The question is about a sense of humor. We all have a sense of humor. We all love to laugh, in fact. And we have the great instincts of laughing at ourselves. That's what bothers me about the Chinese. They don't know how to laugh at themselves. And they focus on previous dynasties, you know, the Ding Dong dynasty of, you know, 500 years ago, rather than, that may not be an exactly historically accurate term, but even the Russians in their heyday with the Soviet Union under their, with their magazine Crocodile, were able to have scathing humor. So I look at nations in terms of the humor index as an indicator of maturity. I also look at their system of justice, much like our preambular construct says, we establish this nation to establish justice first. I worry about justice departments that are not justice departments for the people rather than for administrations, and that seems to be endemic over many administrations. We need to correct that. I mean, we need the IG, guys, to be the IG, the Inspector General. But to go back to this notion about humor, I do a thing called the eight virtues of leadership, and one of them is, the seventh one actually, is the ability to laugh at yourself, the ability to see humor even when it's not there, as a carrying mechanism, both individually and as a society. My mother was great. Can I tell you my mother's favorite joke? High school. One of my guys is over, friends, and he goes to my mother and he says, Mrs. Borling, he says, I want to get a girl who's got it here. And I want a woman, you know, a young woman who's got it here, and a woman who's got it here. And my mother said to Steve Ladd, was the guy's name, she said, Steve, she said, I understand why you want a woman with brains and why you want a woman with a little money. Why do you want a woman with arthritis in her hands? I think we should not have arthritis in our brains and be able to laugh. So if anything, I thank my mother for having that kind of orientation. Yes, sir. I have been in Springfield many times because of the Lincoln Academy that I referenced earlier, and I have been with some unsuccessful forays into the political realm down here in Sangamon County. I don't think I've come down and talked specifically about this stuff, no. Well, there's a number of us, you know, who are, you know. Yeah, the story's in the book, as I, so, you know, you buy your requisite 10 copies, you'll know. You know, the, next question. The reality is it was shouted at me when I was in a place called Heartbreak Hotel, which was the first place really being worked over. I couldn't walk, so they were dragging me around like potatoes, but would hang you up like a pinata and do things to you. And one of the guys down the hall said, about this tap code, put the alphabet in 25 things. A is 1-1, B is 1-2, G is 2-2. Figure it out, dummy. You know, about that time, he got hit, I got hit, we, you know. And then, scratched on the wall was this thing. But this code was brought in by the third POW who was shot down, Smitty Harris, Colonel Harris, retired. And Smitty had been held behind at Stead Air Force Base, which was the survival school back in those days. That's where I went through my instructor training as a survival instructor. And they basically, it was, you'll never need this, but here's something you may think about. And in fact, he was the guy who promulgated it and ensured that it spread through the system. It was our only way of maintaining solidarity and resistance and passing information back and forth. I lived next to Robbie Reisner. I lived next to Jim Stockdale. And we would, you know, pass those kinds of things along in order to keep that cohesion, keep the faith, do the best. And the answer was, do the best you can. You're going to get your, the indelicate phrase, you're going to get your ass handed to you. Bend, don't break. Stay in control if you can. And So that was the reality of the situation. Yes, sir.
You get a big, much too young group than needed.
I try to spend, I'm on the road a lot in terms of speaking. A lot of it is not on this book thing. And I, much like the Medal of Honor Society guys, and I'm helping the Medal of Honor Foundation, the Museum Foundation, raise up the Medal of Honor Museum in Charleston. You ought to look at that on the web, mohmuseum.org. Gary Sinise is the spokesman. Gary honored me with, if you look at the inside cover, with a few thoughts. And it's a very worthy thing. And they focus on the middle schoolers, but I really think they need to expand to all of America with the realities of the Medal of Honor. That's where the word hero comes full force. So yeah, I go about and, as I can, talk to smaller groups, classroom kids. You want a terrible story about talking to... No, I'm not going to tell you. All right. You want me to tell you? 3,000 kids, middle school, 6th, 7th, 8th grade, inner city school, but very variegated in terms of racial structure. Several hundred adults, huge auditorium, and I have been told I have 7 minutes. And I said, okay, 7 minutes. They keep coming out, you have 7 minutes. This is in the middle of the program. So the guy is introducing me, and the lady comes out. She said, we made a mistake, go for 45. and the guy said, this is General Borling. You know, then I'm on. And so this required a certain amount of creativity and thing. And the kids all had different colored shirts on. There were gray shirts, black shirts, and red shirts. And so I was dividing them up into teams, and we were doing little contests and things, and we were, you know, kind of get them zinging. And they had it dark, like the sides here, and I said, go open up the window. So we filled the place with light, and I was trying to go through some quality of life things with them and not do what old people do, which is lecture to the young. It is our privilege. It is their privilege not to listen. We both guard our privilege with tenacity. But the world keeps rocking along anyway, so I'm rocking along and hacking the course, if you will, judging by some reactions. I'm talking about the three R's. And nobody knew what the three, it was like the kids in Puerto Rico, nobody knew what the three R's were, except the adults, you know, reading, writing, and arithmetic. And I had said, well, reading's right, but let's make it recognition and respect. Instead of reading, recognition, and then trying to turn stories out. And I said, you know, at the end of the day, you're going to find out in life, and I'm looking at this bevy of shirts out there, the gray, the black, the red. I said, there's good people, and there's black people. Oh, no, I really said that. And I said, and I stepped forward, I said, that's the dumbest thing I have ever said on a public stage in my entire life. I obviously meant good people and bad people. Will you guys give me a pass because I really screwed up? And they immediately responded with a yes. And I went on and made my remarks for another 15, 20 minutes, and I said, you know, I'm still laboring under that big screw-up. And I could use a worse word than that. That's what I said to the kids. And they all knew the word, of course. And they all laughed, and I said, and once again, I apologize, because that's not what I think, that's not what I believe. I was just trying too hard. Thanks for giving me the pass. The instructional part of that is, and they teach you this at Harvard Business School, that we're all going to make mistakes, we're all going to fail at something, and when you do, when they come to you, it's generally not the sin or the fault. It's failure to own up. And Harvard Business School technology or terminology, shine a light on it. Shine a light on you. And so they were willing to accept, as you are tonight, an imperfect John Borling, but one whose bias is trying to be honest, trying to be authentic, trying to be worthy of your attention. I'll carry that with me to my grave. Go ahead. You got to project because I can't hear what you're saying. She can't hear you here, so how the hell can I hear you? Yes, sir. The Pueblo, yeah.
They attributed to their ability to go back to their SEAL training. And I was wondering, you said, you mentioned that you went through survival training. Did you also go through a similar
training? The question was, when you go through survival training, you know, how to exist on, you know, rabbit's eyeballs and pieces of green this and that. Do they give you SERI training or survival escape invasion resistance training, series, something like that. That's a Navy term, actually. And yeah, we got some of that. They put us into a POW camp, you know, locked us up into small boxes. The Navy actually did waterboarding. We didn't use waterboarding, but they beat you in the Air Force. We weren't as creative, I guess, as the Navy, but, you know, you're closer to the water. So anyway, they did that, and it was very realistic, but it still was a POW kind of environment, and we did not get that ever with the Geneva Convention Accords in North Vietnam. It got better, we all would have died up there, but we didn't ever achieve POW status. I will comment that we got wind of stuff later in the war, and that was, we certainly were told about all the anti-war stuff, but if you look back in history, you know, Abraham Lincoln had probably the biggest anti-war movement on his hands as anyone. I mean, look at the 1864. He's going out for 500,000 volunteers, and he says, if necessary, well, you know, you states will draft them. I mean, there was all kinds of, quote, excess. But we did get word about this strange thing that was happening in America, and that was that people were caring about us, and that they were wearing these bracelets with our names on them. And after the war, I got back 1,000+ of those bracelets with heartrending notes about prayers and thoughts and the effect that I had, and they're so glad that I made it. And I sat down and handwrote answers to every one of those. You know what the strange part is? I still get back these 40+ years later, 150 bracelets a year with stories you wouldn't believe. And one of them is here tonight. Maury up there shows up with my POW bracelet that he wore as a boy and a picture of me on the day I got back to Chicago with Myrna and Lauren, that 7.5-year-old, which I inscribed, and I said, look, it means so much to you, it means more to me that you keep it, but that's the element of care factor that is in there. I will tell you that you get Facebook things, you get calls. Myrna is a little cherry when the divorcee in Kansas City wants me to pick it up by myself, but that's another thought. The reality is that the daughter after the war, Megan, is much more like her mother, and I was around for those things, but Lauren is me. And a little known fact that there was a great party at the White House in 1973. Do people remember when Nixon threw that huge party? We'd just come back, February, March time frame. The largest party ever held at the White House. And later when I worked at the White House, as a matter of fact, we were able to cruise the White House unescorted, even up into the residence. You know, we're up there in the bedrooms and, oh, Fruit of the Loom, look at that, you know. And they had it in this big tent, and, you know, Bob Hope was the MC, and John Wayne, and Myrna was kissed by Sammy Davis Jr. and John Wayne, and They didn't ask to kiss me, and Phyllis Diller was there. I didn't want her to kiss me. So this great party, and years later, Rex Scouten told me, who was the chief usher when I was working there, he said, that was the best party we ever had. Nobody stole anything. I mean, at state dinners, you know, they're making out with the Dolly Madison China stuff. A little known fact. The Lincoln bedroom has an adjoining bath that has a lock on it. In fact, it was from that bath when, in World War II, Churchill and Roosevelt had had an argument at dinner about the name of the post-war organization, and they couldn't agree. Roosevelt struck early in the morning with the idea, had Secret Service wheel him down to the Lincoln bedroom. There's a lock on the bedroom door too, but it was open. He goes in, and Churchill is just emerging from that bathroom, as the Brit would say, starkers. And Roosevelt, according to a colleague of mine, Doris Goodwin, this is where the story comes from, Roosevelt backs off and he said, I'm so sorry, Mr. Prime Minister, I didn't mean to disturb you. As only Churchill could. He said, I assure the President of the United States that His Majesty's Prime Minister has nothing to hide from the... And Roosevelt said, United Nations. And that's how apparently United Nations... Well, anyway, so we got these locks and things in the various rooms up on the residential floors. 9 months later, 50 kids were born after that party. One of them was my daughter, Megan. You'll have to go to the unexpurgated version of this series of remarks to get more, but it was a great party. It was a great party. Look, you guys have been great, too. Have we been going over an hour? My feet are not tired, but I fear that let us say that you are tired. And with your concurrence, and I know you may have a couple more questions, and that's fine. I'll stick around as long as you want. I'm going to go back out, though, and prepare to help the bookstore here break even. So if you're inclined to want to do that, fine, but there's no pressure. But if you have other questions, I'm certainly willing to answer them. I know some people wanted to take some pictures, and Angela says she'd be pleased to pose for as many pictures as you would like. So we can accommodate all of that. Let me come back to the notion. I tried very hard to share some things with you tonight in a light way and then in serious ways. I believe we need to do that throughout our communities and nations, mostly at community level. That's where the rubber meets the road. I'm an optimist about this country. We just got to keep marching. Look out there to all the metaphors that have ever been thrown out from shining cities on hills or beacons in the night or whatever. Let's not be afraid of our own idealistic, without illusions, future. If some of that came through tonight, great. You've been great. Thank you.